happening in Vietnam, and we were giving them an opportunity to do something positive about what was happening there, deliver medical relief. So we often collaborated. And in the summer of 74, when American combat involvement in Vietnam had ended because of the Paris Peace Accords, the United States was still funding the regime in South Vietnam, and the war was continuing, being funded entirely with U.S. dollars. So I came out to California and joined Tom and Jane, and we worked together for a couple of years, trying to lobby Congress and to build support for our lobbying campaign to convince Congress to cut off funding for the war. And we eventually succeeded. In February of 1975, a number of votes occurred in the Congress that terminated funding for South Vietnam. And finally, on April 30th, 1975, the Vietnamese ended the war.
You learned how to lobby, that you could get things happening behind, really, in a sense, behind the door.
And that led to a change in attitude about government. We had been very alienated from government during the war years. We saw the United States government almost as our enemies. They were fighting a war based on lies. They were killing people for no reason. They were using horrible weapons, burning people alive with napalm.
Oh, God, that napalm.
And bombing dikes in North Vietnam that led to some people starving because the crops were destroyed in, you know, in that area. So we were not friends of the U.S. government, but eventually we had to work in the Congress against funding for the war. And in doing that lobbying, we realized that there were numerous members of Congress, both in the House and Senate, who could be influenced by moral arguments and who saw right from wrong. And we began to work more with government as a result.
Bill, I, as you talk and as I read your book, it was as if the leftover generation from World War II couldn't accept that maybe the government wasn't correct. It was when their kids were now old enough to be in Congress that you could lobby them and maybe make a, you know, everything's compromise to work with.
Well, we had to understand at some point that the essence of government is compromise. That society consists of various interests, and government's job is to put all those interests together into a single program. And that's a positive function. So instead of treating government as an enemy, we began to get interested in how government worked. And I began to manage electoral campaigns and get involved with candidates, trying to bring people to government who would govern in a different way than we had witnessed during the war years in the 60s.
Again, using what you learned with the press to make political commercials.
Exactly. I mean, you know, we didn't have access to money back in the 60s with which to buy television commercials or television time to show short educational films. So we had to use what we then called the, you know, the free media, the press, in order to deliver our message. So it was important that we figure out how to manipulate the press to deliver that message, because at the beginning of the war, they were as hostile to what we were saying as anybody else. But we did figure out creative ways of doing
it. Well, you had to make it dramatic for them, because there's a point where you went to the networks and NBC would have nothing to do with you. ABC was sort of maybe, but we have to give it to our lawyers. And it ended up, they said, hey, we can't.
But, you know, there are ways of overcoming that. Students at Berkeley at the very beginning of the war found out the schedule for troop trains bringing soldiers into the Oakland Navy Yards, where they were then put on ships to be sent to Vietnam. So just a few people found out those train schedules and sat on the tracks trying to block the trains from delivering the troops. And of course, when they did that, they called in television cameras. The government ordered the trains not to stop. So there was very dramatic footage of people sitting on tracks, trains bearing down on them, people scampering off the tracks at the last minute to avoid being killed. But the news had to cover it. I mean, that's very dramatic visual news. So it got on the air, And it made it look like the anti-war movement was bigger and more powerful than in fact it was.
Yeah.
This was just a handful of people doing this, but the story got projected nationwide, and it made us seem like we were more influential than we were.
Yeah.
So lots of actions like that in which we did things that the press had to cover and in covering had to deliver our anti-war message.
Now, people hearing this will probably not remember who the man was, but Roy Cohn. I love the idea that he saved you.
Well, at one point, a friend and I were down in the Caribbean, and we had been told that there was some terrific diving in a little sandbar offshore, and we took a boat out there. It was about 2 miles from where we were. And as we approached the little sandbar, our boat sank because it hit coral and sprung a hole. So we spent the afternoon out there, and we did some fishing, and we assumed all the boat traffic coming by, we'd easily be rescued. Well, nobody stopped for us that afternoon, and we had to spend the night on this little sandbar, and in the morning, there was more boat traffic, and we finally flagged down a ship, and the ship put a boat into the water that came to the little sandbar and picked us up and offered to take us back to the mainland. And on the way, I said to the sailor, "Why don't you take us back to the ship for a hot breakfast? We've been on the sandbar all night." And the sailor said, "Well, I was told by the owner specifically not to bring you back to the ship." I said, "Who was the owner?" And he said, "Roy Cohn." So we were probably the only left-wing Americans ever rescued by Roy Cohn.
Another man who plays an enormous role in your life, Edward Levy.
Yes.
Who was Edward Levy?
Well, he was the dean of the law school at the University of Chicago for many years, and then was then made the provost of the university, second in command under the president. And in 1966, I was part of a group of students who took over the administration building at the University of Chicago as a war protest. And eventually, we were negotiating with Provost Levy and the president of the university, George Beadle, to give them their building back. And those negotiations were sometimes friendly, sometimes hostile. But Edward Levy and I became acquainted during the course of the negotiations. I was negotiating for the students, he for the university. And 8 years later, well, actually 10 years later, he was the Attorney General of the United States under President Ford. And I was under federal criminal indictment for the airlift to Wounded Knee, which we discussed earlier. Yeah. And when he was finally appointed Attorney General by President Ford, he took a look at the prosecution of the airlift case and decided to drop charges.
Yeah.
So 10 years after being his antagonist in the negotiations to return the Ed building to the university, we struck up a relationship that saved me from 15 years in prison much later.
Did you get to talk to him at that point?
No, that would have been improper because he had the authority as Attorney General, and it wouldn't have been right for us to be negotiating as friends
behind
the scenes.
And since then?
No, we haven't had
your
any.
Your paths haven't crossed.
No, our paths did not cross, and he died some years later.
Yeah.
So there wasn't an opportunity after a while.
But you were important in getting Harold Washington. Now that you are legitimate businessman, a political advisor.
I became a political consultant, and after the war ended, and I did a lot of campaigns for progressive candidate people running for office. In 1982, I helped a Hispanic man named Tony Anaya become governor of New Mexico. And the following year, they brought me back to Chicago to work on Harold Washington's first campaign for mayor. Mm-hmm. Chicago had never had an African American mayor. Chicago was viewed by the sociologists as the most segregated city in America. Racism was very strong in Chicago, even though it wasn't in Mississippi. In any case, we won. We managed to win that race in 1983, and Harold became the first African American mayor of the city. And some months later, a young African man, or a young man with a funny African name, rather, arrived in Chicago to take a job as a community organizer, Barack Obama. at the age of 24. And he writes about being inspired by Harold Washington's victory and it helping him think for the first time about a career in politics himself.
Had you known Reverend Wright?
No, I did not.
Yeah, because in his book he had been very complimentary about him, and things that Reverend Wright said, I grant you they were exaggerations, but there was some element of truth of what was happening in the world to black people.
Sure.
But I'm going to ask you to read the resulting upheaval that you mentioned here.
Well, this is in reference to all of the movements that emerged from the 60s and the chaos that occurred during it. The resulting upheaval led many of us on both sides of the activist-hippie divide to believe we were on the threshold of dramatic changes in the structure and governance of society. Young people today wonder how so many of us in the 60s took the risks we did, why we sacrificed our careers, our resources, a portion of our own individuality, and occasionally our liberty or personal safety. The reason was simple enough. Whether we were political activists or part of the counterculture, we felt, not just intellectually but viscerally, that a new social order lay just over the horizon, and that within it we would find more liberated and meaningful lives. Whatever our initial motivation, we were swept up, consciously or not, in the hope that a new world was coming. We took the risks we did because we believed, however erroneously, that it would rescue us and provide for our needs. Of course, that all seems hopelessly naive today. My generation may have had a profound impact on America, but we failed to fundamentally alter the social and political order. Much of our activism was later dissipated by identity politics and meaningless theoretical disputes, and the counterculture we created to oppose corporate domination has since been co-opted by it. More realistic generations followed and can now fight for fundamental change in more practical and less outrageous ways. No one should look back at the risks we took and judge our actions as either irrational or especially courageous. They were neither. We did what we did because it made sense in the context of our time, just as other actions make sense in other times.
What are your children doing today?
Well, both of my children are lawyers. One of them is currently employed as a law clerk by a judge for the Ninth U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals, and the other is working in New York. But both of them are committed to the same political ideals that inform that book.
But what's interesting is they learned the legal law part before getting into it.
Yes, yes. It was quite the opposite for people in my generation.
Yeah. Yeah.
We became activists, and then many people, including my wife, their mother, became a lawyer and tried to continue advancing the struggles of the 60s through the courts.
Well, I must say the women's movement, unfortunately, the next generation isn't as strong because it's been done for them.
Well, I'll leave comments on the women's movement to you.
Okay. There you are. Thank you so much, Bill. Will you autograph your book?
I'd be happy to.
Thank you. And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. Visit there, and you can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier, and you can link into Claremont Graduate University that has digitized over 700 of our programs. Then you can go to YouTube, but go to your library. That's even better. Take out books on that era. And even Tom Hayden's written some books. You may not agree with him, but it's interesting to get another point of view. Then, of course, it's the history of Jack Kennedy and the assassination. Bobby Kennedy, who hadn't been such a liberal in the beginning, but grew as a human. Anyhow, those are just some of the books you'll find at the library, and we'll see you next time. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Connie.